Tanto Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Six Victories, North Africa, Malta and the Mediterranean Convoy War, November 1941 to March 1942, by Vincent O'Hara, narrated by Michael Page. Publisher's note: in this audio edition, you will hear references to tables, figures, and maps present in the print and ebook formats of the book. Introduction. Victory has 100 fathers. La vittoria trovò 100 padri, a nessuno vuole riconoscere l'insuccesso. Victory has 100 fathers. No one wants to acknowledge failure. Ciano Diary, 9 September 1942. On 23 March 1942, the fourth day of spring, a gale lashed the central Mediterranean. Two freighters, yawing through a heavy following swell, approached Malta, while a pair of hurricanes patrolled overhead. Hundreds of islanders had gathered along the medieval ramparts guarding Grand Harbour. When the leading ship passed St. Elmo Light, the islanders cheered. The vessel was the first transport to reach the island in almost 2 months. "I felt a lump in my throat at our reception," a British officer wrote. Yet 3 days later, both ships had been sunk and most of their cargo lost. The happy moment of their arrival had been a false promise, and almost 3 months would go by before another supply ship passed St. Elmo Light. Why start in Malta? The Italian admiral and historian Giuseppe Fioravanzo wrote that two critical operational and logistical vectors intersected in the central Mediterranean, an Italian vector running from Italy to North Africa and a British one stretching from Gibraltar through Malta and onto Suez. The war could have been won locally if one of the two antagonists had, on their own, broken the line of the other, he wrote. The chafing of these vectors generated much of the conflict between the Axis and Western Allies from June 1940 through May 1943. The period from November 1941 through March 1942 is especially important. The intertwined struggle during these months to maintain Malta and to supply the armies in Africa illustrates the importance of sea power. It shows how maritime dominance is secured, how it can impact land operations, how it is maintained, and what consequences its loss carries. In October 1941, Great Britain had lofty expectations of winning a decisive victory in the Mediterranean. The Admiralty acted to intensify its attacks against Axis maritime traffic and assist a forthcoming North African offensive by basing Force K, comprising two small cruisers and two destroyers, at Malta. At first, Force K proved wildly successful, and British warships won powerful victories in November and December 1941. By the middle of December, the Royal Navy had a chokehold on the Axis army in Africa. The British army had ended an 8-month siege of Tobruk and was advancing through Cyrenaica. Yet over a span of just 36 hours, the Italian Navy won three critical victories that frustrated British ambitions and dramatically transformed the balance of power at sea. The period ended with the triumph of Axis sea power, confirmed in the late March 1942 Second Battle of Sirte, the failure of the MW-10 convoy to Malta, and the suppression of Malta as an offensive base. Axis control of the operational logistical intersection enabled the Panzerarmee Afrika's subsequent capture of Tobruk and its advance deep into Egypt. This book's title, Six Victories, reflects how military success is often measured in terms of big events and not without cause, yet its approach to this subject also reflects the cumulative impact of little deeds, and the narrative will reflect this. It may seem full of detail, but detail is the essence of the matter. In these details, such issues as doctrine, technology, training, and command are best illuminated. Only the details can show how communications and intelligence, along with logistics, infrastructure, and geography, influenced operations and impacted the application of sea power. In the details are found the lessons that apply today and into the future. These hundreds of details are the true fathers of victory. The importance of time and other conventions. The Mediterranean War was fought over three time zones, Greenwich Mean Time, or GMT, labelled here as Zebra, or Zone, including Great Britain and Morocco. Alpha, or Central European Time, was 1 hour ahead of GMT and included Spain, Italy, Germany and North Africa between Algeria and Libya. And Beta Time, which was 2 hours ahead of GMT and included Egypt and the Middle East. During the period covered in this work, late October 1941 through the end of March 1942, both sides kept summer time. Thus, clocks were advanced 1 hour from GMT, which was always solar and never adjusted for summertime. The Axis powers set their clocks to alpha plus 1 hour for summertime, no matter what time zone their forces operated in. In shorthand, this is expressed as Z plus 2. The British, on the other hand, generally, but not always, used local time as adjusted for summertime. As a result, forces in Malta followed alpha plus 1 hour for summertime, Z plus 2, while forces in Egypt may have their clocks set at beta plus 1 hour for summertime, Z plus 3. However, all messages containing information from ULTRA, the Allies' top-secret message decoding process, were time-stamped with GMT, regardless of where or when the intercepted and deciphered information was generated. To avoid potential confusion, this book uses Central European summertime, Z plus 2, throughout. Because ULTRA dispatches were always expressed in GMT, the listener simply can add 2 hours to any ULTRA timestamp to reconcile with book times. Times are usually expressed in a code with the time in 24-hour format given first. For example, 0010 is 12:10 a.m. and 1505 is 3:05 p.m. Next, if necessary, comes the zone where Z indicates GMT. If no time zone code is given, book time is used. Finally, two digits indicate the date, so 10:15 Z 19th indicates 10:15 a.m. on the 19th day of the month, GMT. 23:25 3rd is 11:25 p.m. on the 3rd in book time, Z plus 2. Generally, the month and year will be clear from the context, but if not, they are spelled out. In the terms Axis and Allies, Axis powers means Italy and Germany, and British is shorthand for British Empire. Thus, when in Chapter 1 the text states that British troops were sent to Greece, this shorter form is used in preference to the more precise description, that the force included Australian, New Zealand, and British troops. In similar fashion, Axis troops generally refers to a combination of Italian and German forces. Italian means Italian forces only, and German indicates German forces only. The word miles always refers to nautical miles unless otherwise stated. The metric and imperial systems of measurement are used interchangeably, although the imperial system is preferred. Chapter 1. Sea Power and the Mediterranean, 1940-1941. To try to be safe everywhere is to be strong nowhere. Winston Churchill. From June 1940 to May 1943, the central and eastern Mediterranean and North Africa between Suez and Tripoli were the principal sustained battlegrounds for the air, land and sea forces of the British Empire and the Kingdom of Italy. Germany entered the campaign in January 1941, and the Americans did not arrive in force until November 1942. The campaign was characterized by dramatic advances and sudden swings of fortune. With the Sahara Desert to its south, North Africa was like an island. It produced nothing for the support of armies. Every article required for life and war had to be carried there, one account observed. These realities limited the size of the armies and made logistics the overriding concern. Relative supply states and long lines of communication caused the campaign's seesaw advances, retreats, and protracted duration. Because air transportation could satisfy just a small fraction of the materiel requirements, the combatants had to supply North Africa by sea. Accordingly, sea power was crucial to the conduct of the campaign and to its outcome. In its broadest sense, sea power is the ability to transport personnel and material freely over the oceans and the ability to deny the enemy that use. Sea denial is the ability to limit the enemy's maritime traffic even if one's own sea traffic is limited. In 1940, the British and Italian admiralties regarded the battle fleet as the principal instrument of sea power and believed that defeating the enemy fleet was the best way to assert sea power. In 1937, Rear Admiral Oscar Di Giambaradino, a well-regarded Italian naval theorist, wrote, "The objective of every offensive at sea can only be the enemy fleet, and the goal is always and only its destruction." Italy's war plans of 29 May 1940 expressed the intention to commit the bulk of our naval forces, battleship squadrons, as soon as possible against the opponent, before its forces in the Mediterranean can be greatly reinforced and when the battle can happen closer to our bases than the enemy's. Indeed, both sides believed that a fleet action was key to exerting sea power. In the Royal Navy, as its official historian observed, the tradition of seeking decision with the enemy by battle at sea had long been a fundamental precept in the maritime services. In his first action after Italy's declaration of war, Admiral Andrew Cunningham, Commander-in-Chief of the Royal Navy's Mediterranean Fleet, ordered the battle fleet to sweep the North African coast to test Italian reactions. His initial goal was to achieve control of sea communications in the central and eastern Mediterranean. To accomplish that, he wrote, "The destruction of enemy naval forces is a necessary course of action." Appreciating this concept of sea power makes it clear why admiralties treasured their capital ships and regarded the use of battleships, cruisers, and even destroyers to defend or attack traffic as secondary assignments that only diverted such vessels from their primary missions. This concept of sea power determined the building programs of both nations and consequently prescribed the composition of the naval forces that faced each other in the Mediterranean. It defined their training and influenced their use. This was especially true of Italy's navy. The Regia Marina spent much of its limited naval budget on modern battleships and heavy cruisers. It trained its fleet destroyers to support the big ships in daytime actions. Its battle doctrine focused on long-range gunnery. When Italy declared war, it had a pair of excellent battleships about to enter service, but it did not have effective sonar or radar. Its secret special forces unit, Decima Flotilla Mas, was equipped with unreliable prototypes. The Navy had only five modern purpose-built anti-submarine warfare escort vessels. It did not have magnetic triggers for mines or torpedoes. It had no nighttime surface combat doctrine for warships larger than destroyers. Its doctrine for the defense of sea traffic did not envision the routine use of fleet units as convoy escorts. Its weapons and doctrine were important and useful, but in the particular kind of war in which Italy now found itself fighting, the weapons and doctrine that it did not have proved more relevant to the tasks at hand. The decision by both sides to fight an offensive war in North Africa, along with Britain's resolve to defend Malta, set the parameters of sea power in the Mediterranean. For the British, sea power was measured in order of importance by the ability to supply their army in North Africa from outside the theatre, to maintain maritime traffic within the theatre, particularly to frontline ports, and to supply Malta from both inside and outside the theatre. For the Italians, sea power consisted of maintaining maritime communication along the Italian coast and between the mainland, Sicily, Sardinia, and Albania, supplying North Africa, and ensuring the movement of maritime traffic to the western Mediterranean, particularly Spain, and in the Aegean and Black Seas. For both sides, it also included the ability to interfere with enemy traffic and to conduct offensive operations, such as bombardments or amphibious landings, as required. An underappreciated fact of the Mediterranean naval war is that each side had only limited power to interdict its enemy's most important maritime routes. Between June 1940 and May 1943, the Allies did little to interfere with Italy's domestic traffic, which averaged more than 35 ships a day during this period, and there was hardly anything that the Axis forces could do to hinder Allied traffic arriving via the Red Sea, at least after April 1941, when the British captured Italy's naval base in Eritrea. On the other hand, each side had periods of success in stopping enemy traffic travelling either from Italy to Libya or from Egypt or Gibraltar to Malta. Late 1941 to early 1942 was a transitional period when both sides waged the battle of sea control and denial in classic and innovative ways. After a brilliant start, British forces faltered, and the Axis powers emerged supreme in the central Mediterranean. Some context is required to understand these changes fully. Major campaigns that last for months and involve hundreds of thousands of personnel, thousands of aircraft, and hundreds of ships are not fought in isolation. The Mediterranean was not a self-contained theatre of war. It was only a corner in a global conflict. The first item to examine is why the Mediterranean North African campaign was fought at all. Given Italy's position as a peninsula in the central Mediterranean, its dependence upon maritime lines of communication to sustain its economy, and its demonstrated vulnerability to maritime blockade, the Italians naturally sought to control the central Mediterranean. Ideally, they also wanted to secure the British-held exits at the Strait of Gibraltar and the Suez Canal. Moreover, the Suez controlled the access to Italy's East African possessions. And in June 1940, the capture of the canal seemed an achievable objective. Accordingly, after the armistice between France and the Axis, a North African land campaign became a key component of Italian strategy. At the same time, the Mediterranean had long been Great Britain's main transit corridor to the Middle East, India, Malaya, and Australia. When it became apparent that Italy was contemplating war, Britain terminated all trans-Mediterranean commercial traffic and withdrew all but a small fraction of its naval forces to Gibraltar and Egypt. Given this, it is natural to ask why Britain would fight in the Mediterranean at all if there was no maritime traffic to protect, especially when the British Isles were threatened by a possible German invasion. One answer is that Britain needed to defend the eastern Mediterranean to protect its supply of oil from the region. A second is that the British also decided to wage an offensive campaign in the central Mediterranean and to defend Malta despite the difficulty in supplying that island. The British War Cabinet made this decision in September 1940 as part of a strategy that identified the British Empire's vital interests and defined a roadmap for defeating Germany. This strategy persisted even after the Soviet Union, the United States, and Japan entered the war. The British plan declared that the foundation of the Empire's strategy would be the wearing down of Germany by ever-increasing force of economic pressure. A blockade was key, as it had been in World War I from 1914 to 1918. So was oil. The document read, "Apart from ending the war by the defeat of Great Britain, Germany can only improve her oil position to any material extent by driving out our fleet from the eastern Mediterranean, thus ensuring seaborne supplies from Romania and Russia. Therefore, the security of our position in the Middle East is of the utmost importance to our strategy, not only as a base from which to exercise and intensify economic pressure, but as a barrier to prevent our enemies from breaking the blockade." In short, London considered defence of the eastern Mediterranean and the Middle East to be a vital component of the only strategy that would offer a chance of winning the war. Moreover, the Mediterranean was also the only area where effective offensive action was possible. Direct attack on Italy may be the first important step we can take toward the downfall of Germany. In perspective, the Mediterranean North African campaign was fought because it was there that the vital interests of Italy and Great Britain clashed. Still, Britain's top priorities continued to be home defence and the protection of seaborne trade, especially in the North Atlantic, and defending these vital interests sharply reduced the number of forces that otherwise would be available for the Mediterranean and Middle East. There was also the need to account for other threats to imperial hegemony, particularly in Singapore and Malaya, which up through May 1941, the British Chiefs of Staff, although not the Prime Minister, considered the most critical interest for the Empire after the Home Islands themselves. German intervention in Africa in February 1941, followed by the Reich's invasion of Yugoslavia and Greece in April, upset the Mediterranean's balance of forces and threatened Britain's overall position. But the situation improved in June when Germany invaded the Soviet Union. That attack transformed the war's strategic dynamics and gave the British Empire what it most needed, a powerful continental ally. The Soviets were a partner the British did not hesitate to embrace, despite mutual distrust and ideological differences. Although in the short term the thrust of German forces into Russia exposed the Middle East to Axis invasion through Turkey and the Caucasus, London saw an opportunity to seize the initiative. In October 1941, after 16 months of fighting, Britain had slightly improved its original position and was on the cusp of securing an important strategic success over Italy. An offensive that seized all of Africa would bring great reward, and Germany would be too busy in Russia to do much about it. To seize this opportunity, the British launched a campaign in Africa called Operation Crusader. The Parallel War, June 1940 to January 1941. At the beginning of 1940, Italy deployed 9 small infantry divisions in Tripolitania to watch the French, and sent 5 such units to Cyrenaica to face the British, since Comando Supremo, the Italian High Command, expected that the combined French and British Mediterranean fleets would blockade Libya. Its war plan of 8 April 1940 called for a defensive stance sustained by a 6-month stockpile of supplies. The Navy would not need to run convoys to Africa. The collapse of France in May 1940 invalidated everyone's plans. Italian Prime Minister Benito Mussolini declared war on 10 June, anticipating a quick victory and a seat at the peace table alongside German Chancellor Adolf Hitler. With the powerful French fleet and army no longer a factor, Africa suddenly seemed open to exploitation. Yet Supermarina, the Italian naval high command, had only 2 battleships available, both refurbished World War I-era vessels, and lacked enthusiasm for the all-out naval offensive that Mussolini had proclaimed, at least until its new battleships were ready. As for attacking Malta, Supermarina concluded in an 18 June 1940 study that it is not conceivable to attack from the sea with a landing of troops without an intense and protracted preventative aerial action of many days to produce the maximum devastation and exhaust the supply of anti-aircraft ammunition. Italy attacked Malta by air on the war's first day. 94 S-79 trimotor bombers raided the island, dropping 27 tons of bombs. But Italy lacked the aircraft, doctrine, and infrastructure required to maintain the type of sustained air campaign that the Navy wanted. Moreover, the Air Force considered such a campaign pointless. Its raids were enough to keep the British Mediterranean fleet from using the island as a base. With few forces on the island, Malta did not threaten traffic, and with peace anticipated before the end of the year, it would have been foolish to risk decimation of the Italian Air Force in a sterile bombing campaign. In June 1940, Malta was toothless, and the crystal balls in Rome did not foresee the island's future impact. On 16 May, even before Italy declared war, the British Admiralty had suspended all merchant traffic in the Mediterranean. It had no choice given Italy's large submarine fleet and the fact that traffic had to transit the Sicilian Strait within a few dozen miles of enemy air bases. The closure instantly added 20,000 miles and more than 2 months to the round trip between Suez and the Clyde. On 16 June 1940, when it was clear that France would seek an armistice, Dudley Pound, the first Sea Lord, wrote to Admiral Cunningham that he believed that the Atlantic trade must be our first consideration, and ordered him to explore and prepare for the withdrawal of the fleet from the eastern Mediterranean. In a narrow vote, however, the British Defence Committee, chaired by the new Prime Minister Winston Churchill, decided to defend Malta. In addition to the obvious political reasons, Churchill needed quick victories to maintain the nation's will to fight and its international credibility and sense that they could be won in and around the Mediterranean. In Rome, meanwhile, the Italian government scrapped plans for a purely defensive posture in North Africa and decided instead to mount an offensive towards Suez. The capture of Mersa Matruh would bring Italian air forces within range of Alexandria and hopefully drive the British fleet from the Mediterranean. The eventual capture of Suez would open a supply route to Italian East Africa. The decisions on both sides gave the navies of Great Britain and Italy tasks that neither had anticipated before the war. The British needed to sustain Malta, and the Italians needed to build up and support an offensive force in Libya. British strategy during this period presumed that Italy was the weak link in the Axis alliance. The elimination of Italy and the consequent removal of the threat to our control of the eastern Mediterranean would be a strategic success of the first importance, the British War Cabinet concluded. Italy's power of resistance is much less than that of Germany, and direct attack on Italy and her possessions in Africa may be the first important step we can take towards the downfall of Germany. In other words, Britain undertook major offensive operations against Italy in the Mediterranean because it could not do so elsewhere. In the war's first 8 months, the British and Italian navies fought 2 fleet actions and 6 smaller naval engagements. Britain attempted to control the central Mediterranean and reopen it to traffic with a knockout victory over the Italian fleet. This led to the action off Calabria in July 1940, which resulted in an inconclusive skirmish that saw both sides claiming victory. Whatever the claims, Italy's routine traffic in the central Mediterranean continued unabated, while British traffic from Malta to Suez remained blocked, although the British did run heavily escorted convoys to Malta in September and October. A British carrier raid against the major Italian naval base at Taranto in November damaged 3 Italian battleships and permitted accelerated shipments to Malta, but its effects were relatively short-lived, and Italian battleships opposed the next Malta supply operation from Gibraltar 2 weeks later. Malta had minor strategic value during the parallel war period of June 1940 to January 1941. As a former head of the British Naval Historical Branch wrote, it has generally been claimed as having conferred command of the sea upon the British. Such a claim is highly questionable at this remove of time, as the Italians were able to go about their more important occasions, supplying the Italian armies in Albania and Libya across the breadth of the Mediterranean with near daily sailing of convoys and single ships. The first convoy from Italy to Tripoli, carrying 937 men and 2,775 tons of supplies, arrived on 26 June 1940. There were also 73 return convoys involving 158 ships, of which only one was lost. In sum, during the parallel war period, total Italian traffic to and from Africa, excluding coastal convoys, involved 331 commercial vessels, of which 4 vessels, 1.2%, were lost. Traffic to Albania, Greece, and the Aegean Sea in this period totaled 1,480 commercial vessels, of which 0.8%, in terms of gross registered tonnage, was lost. Italy's efforts to oppose supply operations to Malta were similarly ineffective. In the parallel war period, the British sent 28 transports in 8 convoys to Malta, but Italian forces damaged just one ship. There were several reasons that British forces sank less than 1% of Axis shipping in the central Mediterranean, Adriatic, and Aegean Seas during the parallel war period. First, British rules of engagement were designed to limit unrestricted attacks to warships and escorted convoys. Otherwise, stop-and-search rules applied. The Royal Navy maintained these rules until February 1941. Second, most Italian traffic to Tripoli favored the western route along the African shore, yet the British directed reconnaissance operations and most submarine patrols from Malta toward the shorter eastern route. It took British intelligence until mid-December before the realization at last dawned upon the naval authorities at Malta and Alexandria that Italian shipping was being routed to the west. Moreover, Allied submarines did poorly. For example, when the hostilities began, the three Allied boats that were deployed from Malta were lost on their first war patrol. Although both sides could expect their convoys to arrive safely during the parallel war period, British convoys were occasional and heavily protected, while Italian traffic was routine. London could not regularly reinforce the Middle East directly from Great Britain. Traffic to Egypt had to travel a circuitous route via the South Atlantic, the Cape of Good Hope, the Indian Ocean, and the Red Sea, a voyage that was three times longer than the direct Mediterranean route and required three times the shipping to sustain the same level of traffic. At least the longer route was relatively secure once the ships had gotten past Axis submarine patrols in the Atlantic. When the war began, Italy had air and naval forces based in Eritrea on the Red Sea, but these units were isolated and their efforts to interfere with the massive and strongly escorted British convoys moving up the Red Sea inflicted insignificant losses. The lack of fuel and ineffective doctrine greatly reduced the Italian threat. And in April 1941, the British eliminated the danger once and for all by capturing the port of Massawa, Italy's key naval base on the Red Sea. Italy launched a half-hearted offensive in North Africa in September 1940. After a short advance into Egypt, a large Italian army dug in, and in December, a British corps counterattacked and eventually took 130,000 prisoners. After conquering Cyrenaica, the British seemed poised to drive Italy from North Africa. This threat provoked Germany to send in the 10th Flieger Corps and two army divisions. German airstrikes against Malta began in January 1941, and German troops disembarked in Tripoli on 15 February 1941, in the first of three large convoys to run between Naples and Tripoli that month. In sum, neither side dominated the central Mediterranean during the parallel war period. Despite all the naval and air activity, the Italians were able to meet their traffic requirements with little hindrance. The British were able to supply Malta, but had to abandon their most important pre-war Mediterranean shipping route between Suez and Gibraltar. The period of German intervention. Heavy air attacks against a British convoy to Malta and Greece, which departed Gibraltar on 6 January 1941 as part of Operation Excess, marked the end of the parallel war period. None of the cargo ships involved was damaged, but German and Italian dive bombers hit the aircraft carrier Illustrious 6 times, German aircraft sank a cruiser, and an Italian mine crippled a British destroyer. Far worse from the British point of view, however, was the arrival of German troops in Africa, which came just as Britain was pulling divisions from Libya and sending them to Greece. Between 4 March 1941 and 18 April, some 20 convoys totaling 173 merchant ships and 3 transport lifts of 3 cruisers each departed Egyptian ports. In these convoys and lifts, the Royal Navy delivered 58,364 men, 8,588 tons of arms and equipment, and much other materiel to Greece. German aircraft flying out of Sicily sank 6 ships from these convoys, while Italian aircraft dispatched 1 ship and damaged another. Decima Mas, the Italian Special Forces unit, in its first operational success, sank the heavy cruiser York and a tanker. The Italian submarine Umbra sank the light cruiser Bonaventure, but 3 Italian submarines patrolling the passage east of Crete and 8 others in the sea lanes south of Crete failed to damage seriously or sink any merchant ships and recorded just 3 unsuccessful attacks against warships. At the same time, during March, Italy transported almost 93,000 tons of materiel to Africa in 27 convoys that included 80 ships, the highest monthly total of the war to date. The traffic to Albania was even greater, with 530 sailings. Allied submarines were ineffective in opposing this traffic. Utmost attacked an inbound convoy and torpedoed two ships, while Upright torpedoed a northbound freighter on the last day of the month. In short, during March 1941, the central and eastern Mediterranean teemed with shipping, but hardly any was lost on either side. Italy's major naval action during this period was the dispatch of a battleship strike force to the waters south of Crete. In the first case of the effective operational use of ultra-intelligence in the Mediterranean naval war, the British received hints that an Italian fleet movement was in the works and immediately suspended traffic between Egypt and Greece. The Italian force, commanded by Vice Admiral Angelo Iacchino, chased a British cruiser squadron but only hit the enemy with a few splinters. In return, Iacchino stirred a hornet's nest of enemy bombers. Swordfish aircraft eventually torpedoed his battleship Vittorio Veneto and immobilized a heavy cruiser. This would have been bad enough for the Italians, but the British battle fleet caught up to the damaged cruiser and, in a night encounter, sank her and two other cruisers that had been sent to her rescue, as well as two destroyers. The event, which entered history as the Battle of Matapan, reduced Italy's surface warfare capacity at a critical juncture. It prompted the Italians to limit the use of their capital ships in waters dominated by enemy air, and to regret that they had not made a greater effort to develop radar and aircraft carriers. Italian critics of the operation subsequently complained that it had served no purpose and was forced on a reluctant supermarina by German pressure, but this was not true. Had the Vittorio Veneto and her attendant cruisers merely made an appearance and then successfully returned to port, they would have asserted sea power in the Western Aegean by establishing a viable threat. If they had surprised a convoy, the entire program of reinforcing Greece would have been jeopardized. And even after their own victory, the British felt the need to deploy battleships to protect convoys from surface threats to the west. In those 8 months, sea traffic to Malta was almost identical to that of the 8 months of the parallel war period, although these later convoys delivered a greater amount of tonnage. 29 ships were sent and 27 arrived. The Axis sank two, 6.9%, including one that sailed independently, and damaged one. The Axis forces could still not prevent traffic to Malta, although they did better than they had done during the parallel war period. The British, however, were slowly squeezing traffic to Africa. There were also 151 return convoys involving 380 ships, of which five were lost. In total, the African traffic, excluding coastal convoys that sailed during the period of German intervention, totaled 871 commercial vessels, of which 45 vessels, 5.2%, were lost. Traffic to Albania, Greece, and the Aegean in this period totaled 1,299 commercial vessels, of which 0.3% were lost in terms of GRT, gross registered tonnage. In March, an Axis offensive threw the British out of Cyrenaica, except for an enclave around Tobruk, which then, like Malta, had to be sustained by sea. On 8 April 1941, the Germans, Italians, Hungarians, and Bulgarians invaded Yugoslavia and Greece. On 24 April, the British began evacuating Greece. Almost 50,000 troops got out, but the Royal Navy paid a price. Axis aircraft operating over the evacuation ports sank two British destroyers and three transports. In May, German paratroopers drove Imperial troops from Crete, forcing another evacuation. During this evacuation, the British Mediterranean fleet suffered crippling losses. Axis aircraft damaged 28 warships, including two battleships and the only carrier, and sank four cruisers and six destroyers. According to British records, during the 3 months that traffic to and from Greece was at its height, March, April, and May, Axis forces sank or captured 125 Allied and neutral merchant ships, displacing 375,080 GRT. Italian submarines did not account for a single vessel. Aircraft sank 102 ships, displacing 323,090 GRT. In the same period, the Allies lost 37 warships, displacing 62,460 tons. From July through September, the British Navy's workload decreased, especially after Imperial troops overthrew the Iraqi government in May and finished conquering French Syria in July. Following these achievements, Libya-Egypt was the Middle Eastern Command's only active land front. There, both sides focused on building up their forces following the defeat of the British brevity and battle axe offensives in May and June of 1941. British efforts against Axis African traffic were ineffective during the first 6 months of 1941, apart from the 16 April interception of the five-ship German-Italian Tarigo convoy by British destroyers temporarily based in Malta, which resulted in the loss of five merchantmen that together displaced 14,398 GRT. In fact, June 1941 was the second most productive month for the Axis, measured in terms of materiel delivered to North Africa. In July, however, British aircraft and submarines finally began chipping away at African traffic. A close look at July, August, September, and October 1941 shows why British efforts against traffic suddenly became more productive. The first reason was that the British had better intelligence. To be sure, Ultra initially had many problems in terms of interpretation, confidence, and use, and these are discussed at length in the next chapter. But special intelligence also led to some notable successes. The submarine Upholder's ambush of the Oceania, 19,403 GRT, and Neptunia, 19,328 GRT, on 17 September, for example, accounted for a third of the total tonnage lost in transit to Africa in the July-September period. Ultra enabled the British to pre-position submarines, as in the case of Upholder, and concentrate reconnaissance aircraft at times and in areas where intelligence indicated traffic would pass. The improvement and greater use of airborne surface vessel, ASV, radar in 1941 amplified the impact of better intelligence by making reconnaissance aircraft more effective, especially at night. The Mark II version had a range of up to 60 miles, although 20 miles was the limit for a destroyer-sized target. ASV-equipped Hudsons, Wellingtons, and Swordfish began operating out of Gibraltar and Malta from mid-1941. The second factor was a reduction in the British Navy's major responsibilities. As Admiral Cunningham fretted in an 18 May 1941 letter to Pound, "This waiting for the Crete attack and having to make dispositions for it is hampering the attack on the Libyan trade. I fear they are running a lot of stuff into Benghazi." After the loss of Crete and the conquest of Syria, the British could focus more attention and resources on attacking Axis traffic. The third was Malta's increased capacity as a base, especially following the withdrawal of German air forces from Sicily in May 1941. To operate effectively, forces based in Malta needed intelligence and relative security in addition to supplies and weapons. Malta did not begin to realize the advantages of its geographic position until July 1941. The success of the July and September GM1 and GM2 convoys, combined with Operation Propeller in September, delivered 145,600 tons of supplies to the island. Moreover, 214 hurricanes arrived through June 1941 and another 58 in September. By the beginning of August, Malta was home to the 10th Submarine Flotilla and 145 operational aircraft. There were 22,000 men and 13 battalions, 330 anti-aircraft guns, and 104 artillery pieces for coast defense and field operations. There were five submarines stationed at Gibraltar, of which two were at sea, 10 at Malta, with 7 at sea, and 15 at Alexandria, with 7 at sea. Allied forces sank 25 loaded cargo ships that collectively displaced 145,059 GRT in transit to Africa in the 4 months of July to October, of which submarines and aircraft based in Malta accounted for 16, which together displaced 135,694 tons. To summarize the differences of the July to October period compared to earlier times, The British now could conduct better reconnaissance and field more strike forces with better equipped and more experienced men. At the same time, a few aggressive submarine skippers in more suitable submarines made a great difference in the overall effectiveness of the entire submarine force. And the supply of better aircraft, particularly ASV-equipped Marylands, allowed the British to attack at night as well as during the day. The increased effectiveness of British forces caused the Axis commands to howl. Nonetheless, 80% of the supplies sent to Africa from July through October arrived intact. The land war was static during this period as both sides amassed stocks and prepared to launch an offensive. As Rear Admiral Eberhard Weichholt, the German naval attaché in Rome, summarized, "At the end of 1941, both sides in North Africa were striving for definite victory, the Germans and Italians by capturing Tobruk, and the British by launching a major offensive aimed at relieving Tobruk and destroying the German and Italian troops in Cyrenaica. Reinforcement and supply efforts on both sides became a race against time in which sea transport was the deciding factor." Actions planned. In June 1941, the British Middle Eastern Command consisted of General Archibald Wavell, Admiral Cunningham, and Air Chief Marshal Arthur Tedder. They commanded in consultation one with the other. This committee system was in place throughout the period of this work, even though General Alan Brooke, Chief of the Imperial General Staff, complained, "The committee system is not conducive to firm, decisive, and quick action, which is essential to success in war, but was merely a council of war, the evils of which have been proved in history." After the July 1941 battle axe fiasco, General Claude Auchinleck replaced Wavell. Auchinleck immediately began reorganizing and gathering reinforcements while planning to relieve Tobruk in an offensive codenamed Crusader. To accomplish this, he activated the Eighth Army under Lieutenant General Alan Cunningham, Admiral Andrew Cunningham's younger brother, stockpiled supplies, and advanced the railhead. The government in London was anxious to launch Crusader as soon as possible. Churchill had high expectations. On 14 October, the Prime Minister told the Director of Plans, Major General John Kennedy, that "this battle will have a great effect on the war if the attack succeeds. It will be the first defeat inflicted on the Germans by the British. It will have a far-reaching influence upon sentiment throughout the world." This meeting with Churchill captured the tension that powered British strategic planning. The wildly optimistic Prime Minister claimed, "We have been sinking 50% of their shipping," referring to the Axis supplies from Europe to Africa. The mildly pessimistic Kennedy, who remained silent, noted that, "My information was that we had sunk only 17%. In fact, in September 1941, the month immediately preceding this meeting, the British had sunk 18% of the ships engaged in traffic to and from Africa. After the Crusader offensive, the Chiefs of Staff considered several follow-up operations. Acrobat, the conquest of Tripoli, Gymnast, a movement by invitation into French North Africa, and, best of all, Whipcord, an invasion of Sicily. The Chiefs concluded, "It is clear there are great possibilities of fruitful action in the Mediterranean and Middle East areas in the near future. The reopening of the Mediterranean would not only be a great prize in itself, but can alone relieve that shortage of shipping which so gravely hampers our overseas operations whichever way we turn." With respect to shipping, at the end of 1940, the Axis powers in the Mediterranean had available, counting only vessels of more than 500 GRT, 1.981 million GRT of Italian ships and 0.225 million tons of German vessels for a total of 2.206 million GRT, more than sufficient to meet Axis requirements in the Mediterranean. During the summer of 1941, mounting losses on the African route started to worry Berlin and Rome. The Italo-German army in Africa, under the leadership of Lieutenant General Erwin Rommel, was preparing to assault the British enclave at Tobruk. At a 25 August 1941 meeting between Hitler and Mussolini, the Axis leaders agreed that, contingent upon the free flow of supplies, their forces would be ready to attack Tobruk by the beginning of October. This would give the Axis a third port in North Africa, simplify the problem of defending Libya, and facilitate moves towards Suez in 1942. Although Berlin's strategic focus was on Russia, German planners remained absolutely confident that Russia would be defeated and that the war's next phase would include a strategic redeployment toward the Middle East. As it turned out, Rommel postponed his offensive and complained to Hitler that the Italians were not adequately protecting his supplies. Hitler therefore ordered German naval forces into the Mediterranean for the first time, without taking Italian operations into consideration. In addition, starting in mid-September, the German 10th Flieger Corps in Greece began to protect some traffic. Apart from a few minor actions, the British and Axis armies in Libya had stood pat for 4 months, preparing their attacks. Such a delay testified to the logistic challenges they both faced and provided a clear demonstration of the influence of sea power on land operations. Chapter 2. Communications, Intelligence, Logistics. At the moment of battle, information about the strength of the enemy is uncertain, and the estimation of one's own is usually unrealistic. Karl von Clausewitz. The line between disorder and order lies in logistics. Sun Tzu. Communications and logistics influence the practice of sea power in ways both obvious and subtle. Quite obviously, in the case of the Mediterranean North African campaign, logistic requirements determined its character, its zones of action, and its objectives, and it dictated when naval operations were scheduled and how large they would be. More subtly, in the case of the Regia Marina, it even forced ships to use lower cruising speeds at times when higher speeds would have been safer. Quite obviously, too, communications is the foundation of all military interaction. Yet it entails misunderstandings and assumptions whose impact can be subtle indeed. At its core, communications is the multifaceted ability to transmit information and instructions quickly, accurately, and securely. Intelligence is a product of this process. First and foremost, it consists of the collection of information, but it also involves the protection of information and the application of information to strategic, operational, and tactical activities. Many historians say that intelligence greatly affected the Mediterranean campaign and that signals intelligence gave Great Britain a decisive advantage over its Axis foes and was particularly significant in the battle against traffic to North Africa. As early as 1977, one historian wrote that Britain's systematic strangulation of Rommel's services of supply, made possible by its knowledge of Axis schedules and convoy routes, was a decisive ingredient of British victory in the Mediterranean. In 1981, Francis Harry Hinsley, the chief author of the British Official History of Intelligence, wrote, "In the 2 months up to the middle of December 1941, the combination of high-grade shipping intelligence and the presence of Force K in Malta enabled the British forces to bring about a virtual stoppage of Axis supplies to North Africa." Such conclusions, reached 4 decades ago, have stood essentially unchallenged. A close examination of the matter, however, along with an accounting of Axis intelligence and countermeasures, will show that although intelligence often helped Allied operations, it was but one tool of many, and hardly decisive, especially during the period covered in this book. In fact, one expert has asserted that Axis signals intelligence provided valuable operational intelligence against the Royal Navy in the Mediterranean and the British Army in Egypt. All told, Britain arguably lost the signals intelligence war in that theatre between January 1941 and May 1942. A quick review of some basic statistics supports this conclusion. This book covers a period when the Italians sailed 188 convoys or single ships to, from, or along the African shore, and the British sailed 90 convoys to Malta or between Alexandria and Tobruk or other ports in Libya. Ultra informed the British of 82% of Italian convoys or sailings. The British attacked 49, 26%, and inflicted some damage to 30, 16%. The Axis powers, meanwhile, attacked 40% of British convoys and inflicted damage to 21%. Ultra. Radio was a fast and convenient way to transmit messages, but it was not secret. Anyone could intercept a broadcast. As a result, militaries used codes and other means to protect their radio messages from snoopers. These measures ranged from simple substitution codes, where one letter stands for another, and super encryption, which involved coded messages of coded messages, to messages that were scrambled randomly through mechanical devices. The problem was that coded messages slow communications and sometimes limit what can be said. A message sent in a complex code can take hours on both ends to encrypt and decrypt. Mechanical and electromechanical coding machines offered compelling advantages: relative ease of use, faster speeds, and nearly absolute security. Or so it seemed. They became common in the 1930s, and by 1941 all the major powers were using devices such as the German Enigma, the British Typex, the American Sigaba, and the Japanese Purple. Enigma was an electromechanical cipher machine with a keyboard and various complex components such as a series of wired rotors, a fixed reflector, and a plug board that scrambled the electrical currents that entered and exited the rotor maze. The sender typed in a message and gibberish emerged. The recipient entered the gibberish on a machine with the same rotor and plug settings, and the message emerged in readable form. As one expert described the process, to calculate the total number of possible variables built into the Enigma, the cryptanalyst would have to multiply the possible rotor combinations by the possible rotor starting positions by the possible notch positions by the possible wirings of the reflector by the possible combinations of plug-ins. The number of possible combinations, 3.3 times 10 to the power of 114, was greater than the number of atoms in the observable universe. The German Naval Interception and Cipher Unit, B-Dienst, Beobachtungsdienst, knew that Enigma was vulnerable in theory, but every time it studied the matter, B-Dienst concluded that Enigma in ciphered communications was secure. Nonetheless, the Allies, the Poles actually first read Enigma-coded messages, and the French played a significant role, deciphered Enigma-encoded messages by applying resources and talent to the problem, by the mechanization of cryptanalysis, by the physical capture of Enigma machines and codebooks, and last, but in some respects most important, by exploiting the poor practices of some German operators. By 1940, a British unit based at Bletchley Park, England, and called the Government Code and Cipher School, GC&CS, was generating intelligence summaries based on the content of intercepted and deciphered Enigma-encoded radio traffic. The code name for these summaries was Ultra. The British Middle Eastern Command was an Ultra recipient. Between 20 and 26 October 1941, for example, GC&CS sent Cairo 91 Ultra messages, 59 classified as emergency, 18 as immediate, and 14 as important. 35 of these concerned convoys and other shipping movements and included information about composition, departure dates, routes, arrivals, postponements, and corrections of previous messages. There were 18 other naval messages regarding the sailings of warships, policy directives, and navigational matters. 18 messages covered the German Air Force, 12 had to do with logistics, mostly related to the German Air Force, and 8 touched on topics such as order of battle and army movements. The German Air Force's Enigma machines generated 40 of these messages. Others came from the German railway system, the Italian Air Force's C-35, and Italian Naval C-38M Enigma. Yet, with an average of 13 messages a day, this was a light week. From 20 November through 5 December, the average was 31 messages a day. From 6 December through 18 December, it was 35. Because the British did not want the Axis powers to learn that their most secure ciphering system was compromised, Ultra messages were subject to stringent security. Starting on 20 July 1941, the GC&CS sent items to the Middle East via a Special Communications Unit, SCU, within 4 to 12 hours after transmission by the enemy. The SCU sent messages over secure teleprinter lines, or, if it was necessary to use radio, via the one-time pad method using identical pads of tear-off sheets. Although unbreakable, it was a slow and tedious method of communicating. An SCU operative on the other end received the information and passed it to a cipher sergeant from a GCNCS-controlled Special Liaison Unit, SLU. The sergeant deciphered the message, and an SLU intelligence officer, always of relatively low rank to avoid attracting attention, personally delivered the message to the designated recipient in the operational headquarters. Originally, these were Auchinleck, Cunningham, or Tedder. In September 1941, the GCNCS reluctantly included Malta's senior naval officer, Vice Admiral Wilbraham Ford. One SLU officer remembered that such personal messages as came in for Admiral Cunningham were received by him with great courtesy. Also, Air Marshal Tedder always received any personal-only messages with appreciation. However, Tedder's outer office assistant was anything but courteous. In general, I found a better welcome from the top brass than from their underlings. The recipients, in turn, designated staff members to evaluate the information and recommend action. Initially, the numbers of personnel and procedures used to act upon this mass of information were inadequate. Ralph Bennett, a GCNCS translator who spent time in the Middle East in late 1942 and early 1943, wrote, "The full benefits which flowed from ultra-intelligence were long in coming. The results of disseminating ultra-intelligence in 1941 must now be judged on the whole disappointing. Intelligence was then not highly regarded, and those who had the power to use it in battle often lacked the will to do so." He noted that only after the August 1942 Battle of Alam Halfa were ultra-dispatches regarded as a critical resource. Indeed, the dissemination of such intelligence often was so slow that the information was obsolete by the time it was delivered. As British war historian Hinsley conceded, SIGINT, the military acronym for intelligence gathered by intercepting radio and telephone messages, passing on the SCU-SLU from CG and CS to Vice Admiral Malta, and from him operational orders to the senior officer Force K, who was not himself an ultra recipient, was sometimes received too late for action. Process was one problem, content was another.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.